Every year, for a number of years, I've been doing these trends and been writing, and in a number of different publications. I write for Huffington Post and Forbes and TechCrunch and a number of different publications these days. But what I do is I push out some thinking, like with a perspective of where we've come from, where we are today. And I try and make some bold predictions, and I'm making wilder and wilder predictions every year. And I'm pushing out with this view, 2017, the psychedelic cultural reality. And I'll explain a little bit more about that. And some of the predictions in it are pretty wild, so you might completely disagree, that's fine. If you did want to take any pictures or anything, please do. I think we can do hashtag YouWaterloo60, right? Perfect, I've been trained, we're good. So my Twitter handle is @NicholasFuturist, so feel free to reach out, connect with me on LinkedIn after this. Always happy to have a chat, and it typically happens after these presentations. Okay, let's go, we don't have much time. Okay, we actually had a really interesting time in the last couple of years. So 2015, 2016, we've had like the circular and sharing economies been really bolstering up and driving things forward. Content, social media has been changing. There's new influencer networks. You know, we've got wearable computing, virtual reality, artificial intelligence, and big data analytics. It's kind of changing how we look at the world. And I think as we end up in 2017, we're actually starting to feel like there's a pace that we actually have met now. It kind of feels that everything before this year, to me, feels like a test run. We've kind of been playing with wearables. We've been playing with VR. We've been playing with artificial intelligence. I actually think this year we start to get serious. And with that seriousness, we start to find good application. And with that seriousness, we find the big people, the tech companies that are developing technologies to drive us forward, are going to start to find maturity in this space as well. And that's when it's going to become very exciting. So I'm going to take us back to 50 years ago. Not quite 60 years ago, as old as this university. But does anyone know who this is? Yeah? Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So this is Timothy Leary. Very famously said, turn on, tune in, drop out. I actually find it really interesting because I think that we're at a stage today in 2017 of asking ourselves the same questions. You know, do we turn on, tune in, and drop out? Timothy Leary talked about, you know, turning on to the world as a whole and tuning into, you know, the environment and dropping out of university. I'm not saying that we do that, right? But what I am saying is that we're kind of in the year of the tune-in economy. There's been some catastrophic things that have happened in the past couple of years, especially in 2016, around politics, a number of different technological sort of things. I mean, with Edward Snowden back in 2013, the revelations around surveillance and privacy. We're more awake today than ever before. We're really aware of the world around us, what tech companies' role in it is, and we're trying to work out how we fit into that. The world is getting stranger as we go forward. As we do turn on those devices and we tune into the content and we drop out of normal life to spend hours in Facebook, or we're going to spend hours in computer games and VR and whatever, it's going to become much more relevant to think this way. But let me take you back to the beginning of the internet, right? And when the internet first came on, I was at university during this time. I joined the internet club. And at the internet club, we used to go to these old Sun workstations, and there were green screens. I used to dial into Norwegian university servers and check out their library catalogs. It's like, and within a couple of years, there was already like amazing websites by bands like Massive Attack or, you know, Amazon's early sort of incarnations, you know. And so the internet started growing. But there was actually a really important book, and try and find this book to read it, because this is one of the most essential pieces of reading I've ever done. There's an author called Douglas Rushkoff, and he's done a number of different books since then. You go and find him on the internet as well. He does a talk called Throwing Rocks at the Google Bus, which is from his last book as well. He's a great orator and thinker. But back then, he was sort of working out, okay, with the use of psychedelics and physics and maths and the internet and hacking and smart drugs and all these things, everything was going to get strange. So he actually predicted this. Our growing dependence on computers, electronic media has made us easy target, if not unwilling subjects, in one of the most bizarre social experiments of the 20th century. Who feels like we're in a social experiment right now at the mercy of tech companies? Yeah? Who's on Facebook? Yeah, right. this is where we are. These connections are enabled by technology. And that book's fantastic. Who knows what this is? Absolutely no one. It's Tom from MySpace, right? so I was on GeoCities in the early days. I went through Friendster. I had a number of like band, you know, I write music, so I've got a number of pages on MySpace still. I won't tell you where they are. You can try and find them. So, you know, MySpace was quickly superseded by this young man over at Facebook. And then came the acceleration. And it was this man. The iPhone's 10 years old. Pretty fantastic. But more importantly, the App Store is 9 years old. And over 50 billion apps have been downloaded in the last 9 years, right? We might all use a different number of devices, Android and Apple or whatever in this room. That proliferation is huge. And the world is an app-based situation for us all in our daily lives. What's interesting is that more people on Earth have got access to mobile technology today than have actually got access to clean running water, right? That's over 6 billion people have got access to phones. About a third, 30-35% of those people have actually got smartphones, and that's growing. They're saying by 2020, the number of mobile devices like tablets and smartphones are going to outnumber the number of PCs bought in the world and used in the world. So we're moving towards a mobile discipline with our lives. And within that, we're finding that we're changing demographics. I imagine most people in this room, with the occasional exception, are actually millennials, right? Always like to call them thumb tribes, right? Heads down, you know. Justin Bieber goes out to like Central Park and everyone's playing Pokemon Go and don't know who he is, right? Thumb tribes, smombies. Have you heard of the phrase smombies? Smartphone zombies, right? I actually installed Pokemon Go last year, and I played it for a couple of days just to work out the phenomenon. And it was like, I was walking down the street about four blocks and I didn't look up from my phone. I crossed the street and I didn't get run over. I didn't bump into people. It's like that peripheral vision. It's like we're amazing at doing this way of being completely plugged into our mobile environment. So we're all smombies. Who isn't a smombie in this room? Okay, you're not. Okay, fine. You will be. Okay, but what's interesting is social media has changed. Snapchat, I tried to use Snapchat for a while, it just sucked up all my data. But about 10 billion views of snaps per day. About 470 million new snaps per day are posted. They still haven't worked out how to monetize it properly. So they're going to IPO this year for about 35 billion, and then still no one's going to know how valuable it is, right? And then social media's kind of become this, you know, Instagram, my life is a party. Snapchat, my life is a quirky TV show. Hi. Facebook, my life turned out great. And Twitter, we're all going to die. I found this the other day just through Twitter. And I think this is a perfect sort of description of where we are. It's kind of, we're spreading ourselves thin and we're telling different stories through different channels. And none of it's really making that much sense. There's multiple versions of who we are. We've got digital schizophrenia, and that's something else from Douglas Rushkoff. And then we've got the Gen Z, which is the kids that are going to come after us. This is really the activist generation. I actually think that Generation Skip, a generation, they're like two generations back. So the Gen Z are like the Gen Xers. I'm a Gen Xer. We want to like break the world and rebuild it. But back in the day, we would actually like, you know, riot on the streets, right? I didn't do that. But this activist generation were born with technology in their hands, basically. How many like one-year-olds have you seen like swiping and using?
Swiping a book.
Exactly. Yeah, this is it. It's the change, and it's not necessarily a good thing. We can talk about digital dementia and how it affects brainwaves. We've got to be careful with that. But it's all changing. And as the younger generations come in, they're all hugely influenced by technology. Now, it's interesting, the age of technology. Today, the most powerful companies in the world are tech companies. Sure, like we've still got ExxonMobil in the 2016 graph here. But if you look back to just 10 years, it was mostly like utility oil conglomerate companies that were the most powerful companies in the world. This is why the whole energy landscape is going to change towards renewables, and this is how all the oil companies are going to be out of business. Even countries like Saudi Arabia are trying to get to the year 2030 to be not reliant on the use of oil for their economy, right? But these tech companies are growing, and why? And how? Well, we're generating more information now than we ever did. We actually think that we're going to be at about 44 zettabytes of data in the world by 2020. We're growing and growing and growing. We produce more data today than we did the previous 2 years, in just one day, right? So more and more is actually coming into our lives. But what are we doing with all that data? We've all heard the term big data. There's more processing, there's more storage, there's more analytics. And these are the people that are taking advantage. Now, I've chosen American companies. And the reason I've chosen American companies, and actually stating, you know, there's a $2.5 trillion total value. If these guys got together, they would be like the 11th largest country in the world, just behind France. These are all the advisory committee on the tech committee for Donald Trump. Imagine the influence that these companies have on the entire world about changing how we all operate, what we do, how we consume content, what data is collected, how that's used by not only these companies, by ourselves, by organizations, and by government as well. Hugely influential. And we've got lots of research. I was just over at the nanotechnology and the quantum computing center earlier. And talk about having my mind blown open, right? It's amazing. There's some amazing things happening here at the University of Waterloo. But there's all these different technologies that are coming up. Everything like, you can go all the way back at smart dust. You can spread sensors out into the world and they just like float around and move around and collect data. You know, the Internet of Things, it's coming. You know, we've got natural language questioning. We've got cognitive expert advisors. You know, the things are going to get smarter in our pockets. So I try and cut through all of that and I try and start working out predictions. First prediction, big tech companies will have increased influence over governments at the policy level. This is kind of scary stuff, right? Through data analysis and R&D roadmaps. So, you know, the presidents and premiers and prime ministers sit down and say, hey, tell us where we're going. Influence us as to how our policy should be around data storage and how we can use that. And the people in intelligence say, hey, this is really interesting, let's talk, right? And we talked a little bit about that last night. So prediction number one, tech companies, government, a lot stronger linkages. Second prediction here, content consumption is going to happen via multiple channels. Everything's going to be framed as entertainment. Politics today feels like entertainment, right? It's pushed out through social media. And it'd be used as advertising and for political means. So it's going to get confusing. The world's going to get really confusing for us all. And I'm calling this the psychedelic cultural reality. It's that idea that nothing is going to seem that real in front of us as technology comes into our lives. It's going to be stranger and stranger until we feel that life is normal again. It's still going to feel very, very off-kilter. The world will feel artificial, visually overloaded, and uncomfortable. Designers will experiment with new experiences in the world, with all the privilege acting as willing guinea pigs. And the reason I'm saying privileged is because this technology is going to be fairly expensive, right? I'll talk about that a little bit more as we go through. I mean, an iPhone is like, what, $1,100 if you get something unlocked these days? That's not entry-level technology. That's privileged technology. So I'm going to talk about these five things, and there's going to be an extra one at the end as well, but I'm not going to say what that is until we get there. That's a surprise. We're going to talk about virtual reality, mixed reality, artificial intelligence, in what I'm calling intelligence amplification, the commerce revolution, because that's really coming on fast, and automation as well. So let's get into it. Who's used any kind of virtual reality headsets or Google Cardboard or looked at virtual reality on their phones, right? Yeah, quite a few people in the room, I'd say like over 50% of people. It's really easy to get in there. The New York Times has got a bunch of applications. You can download a bunch of things. It costs like $5 to $10 to buy a headset made out of cardboard. A little bit more to get one that's a little bigger. Like Samsung Gear has sold like 5 million units of its VR technology now. And it's interesting, there's actually a psychedelic philosopher called Terence McKenna, and I pulled this out of the Douglas Rushkoff book, that talks about how we're closing a distance with the most profound event that a planetary ecology can encounter. He's a pretty heavy guy if you read Terence McKenna, which is the freeing of life from the chrysalis of matter. It's that idea that we can suddenly go into a world and we won't be here, we'll be somewhere else. And that's what virtual reality is, and it's been around for a long time. This is a guy called Jaron Lanier, who started developing a lot of the early versions of virtual reality used by people like NASA back in 1984. What's crazy about Jaron Lanier, he's an amazing speaker. Go and find some things that he talks about on YouTube. He's written a couple of amazing books like You Are Not a Gadget and Who Owns the Future. He kind of looks exactly the same today. You know, he either looked really old back then, or he kind of looks super young now. I think he looks super young now. He's a great thinker. And then you got this guy, Mark Zuckerberg. Look how happy he is. Look, about 1,000 people just disappeared into virtual reality, and he's like, I know where these guys are going now that I own Oculus. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute. As I said, 5 million Gear VR virtual reality headsets have been sold to date. Snap? Who's got any Snap glasses in here? They haven't really come to Canada yet, which is a bit of a shame. But this is the new wearable by Snapchat. Now it's known as Snap. And you, literally, the form factor is walk around, take a picture. Directly. It's a perfect millennial content capture device. And loads of people want these. They've actually got these booths and people queue up outside. And in fact, some people pay homeless people to wait to actually get these devices because they're in such high demand. This is kind of the crazy world we're in, the psychedelic cultural reality, right? And then we've got some really interesting headsets coming up. You might have seen this from CES. This is the Bridge headset. And what's interesting is that it's got sensors and cameras. So you actually look at augmented reality through into the world as well as having a virtual immersive world. So this is where we start to cross over into something where something not real actually exists in the real world, sat right next to you. And it taps you on the shoulder and says, hey, aren't you plugged into the internet? Or something, right? And then this is what Mark Zuckerberg's working on with his team at Facebook. I was going to show the video, but it's a very, very long video. But it's the idea that you can use Facebook virtual reality, and you've got these avatars and friends, and you've got like people like doing all of these expressive sort of motions, or you're traveling, or you're in a meeting, or you're on the phone with your wife and you're doing selfies. It's incredible. I actually think that this is an incredibly useful vision of what virtual reality can be. And it's really interesting that they've kept a very avatar-like existence for us, because sometimes it's a little creepy if we look too much like the real world. I actually think this is what's going to happen with Facebook VR. I think it's going to create 3 times the amount of engagement within its platforms and the users, with those users that are plugged into that experience. I think on average in Canada, people spend about 80 to 90 minutes a week on Facebook. Does that sound about right to the people in the room? Maybe? Imagine spending 3 times the amount of time, because what you're doing, you're actually immersed there in the evening chatting to your mum and dad, or you're chatting to your brother or sister or some of your best friends across the world in the experiences that they're having. This is the roadmap for VR. It's going to be the people sat in the room, like maybe on an intravenous drip, just like off in the old world. That's probably a little extreme. It's definitely going to happen for some people. What's really interesting about these virtual personas, and as you're going to be in these avatar kind of environments, we're going to be interacting with each other, and we're going to have to create these bigger than life personas. We're going to become actors. And do you know what? Some of those people are going to bring it out into the real world, and it's going to be way more irritating than selfies. Right? We already know what that's like, right? But the emoticon is going to disappear, and the overacting is going to come into play. And then we cross into what's called mixed reality. This was an image that came out about 2 years ago from a company called Magic Leap. It was leaked from their office in Florida. It was taken through whatever optical machine that they had, because it was quite a large form factor, some say at the time. And this is a non-real hammerhead head shark swimming around this room, in and around this guy. How real does that look? They call this cinematic reality. An absolute cinematic reality in the real world surrounding all of us. The idea that I could put on a headset and this room would have ghosts floating around, or sharks swimming around you, or whatever, right? And some people have got a very alternate view of what the world could become. This is a guy called Keiichi Matsuda, who I was actually turned on to him by Nora Young from CBC Spark. And he has a vision about what the future can look like through augmented reality. So let's look a little bit of his video called Hyperreality.
Still living in
pure information overload, right? So what's really interesting with his vision of this future is that every single surface that we can lay our hands on, every single experience that we can touch, has got this augmented experience. Everything's a game, right? And this is, I think, where we're actually headed. Now, this isn't real technology, this is all CGI, but I think this is a good indicator from an academic perspective of like, hey, this is where we could go. Go and watch the whole video. I think it's filmed down in Colombia, I think in Medellin, and it's fascinating. By the end of it, she loses all her points, she gets robbed in the street, and she has to go back and reboot. It's all very dystopian. But these are some of the companies that are kind of trying to make that reality happen. I mean, I don't know if anyone's tried the Microsoft HoloLens. That's available now. It's about $4,000 or $5,000 like Canadian dollars to buy this big headset. But you can actually see these images in the real world. Still quite rudimentary right now. Some other headsets, ODG was just announced their new headsets at CES. They've been doing a lot of the military heads-up display for years and years. They've actually got a really small form factor set of glasses now. Meta does as well. The one that I'm very, very excited about is Magic Leap. And Magic Leap's the technology where you had that shark earlier. And I think this year they're going to announce their glasses. And what they actually do is they use a different kind of technology where they actually build the cinematic images directly onto the retina using lenses. And it's so real that they've had to turn the contrast up so that people know what's not real and what is real in the real world. This is kind of going to be interesting. And people have seen what Meta can do. People have seen what Microsoft can do. People have seen what ODG can do. No one's seen what these guys can do. But I was chatting to someone yesterday. So I've got some grads in my course, and they did an internship, and they said it's like drugs. But what's really interesting, that's why I'm calling it this psychedelic reality. We're going to have these injected experiences into our lives, and we're going to love it. But we're not going to know what's real and what's not real. One of my great friends, Karis O'Connor, calls it the twitchy reality. Here's my first prediction here. Tech companies will use this mixed reality to deliver entertainment and or what I think is distraction and turn every transparent surface into an information layer. So imagine every car windshield and every window, and suddenly it's like, oh, you know, suddenly we can put video screens up there, or things can float in front of our eyes, or, you know, we can augment the world around us. I think mobile device-based mixed reality will be the tipping point. When it's small enough and cheap enough to be in our pockets, it means that cost effectiveness will mean that more people will access it, more people will develop for it, and it's going to become more ubiquitous. I think Apple's going to do something really interesting with it this year. They're already talking about using OLED and transparent screens. There's speculation in the last day about them releasing augmented reality glasses. I don't know what's real about that, but I think in 2017 we're going to have something pretty heavy with the iPhone 8, and it's going to be very, very interesting. And I actually think that as we go into this augmented reality world, and we can actually do gesture-based and spatially based sort of interfaces, the point-and-click interfaces and the screens that we touch today will disappear, and there'll be prominence given to a visual and voice-driven experiences in the real world, mostly driven by artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence, that's a nice segue. So there's a lot in the news about AI. I studied it like 23 years ago at university and did like grammatical based systems with it, symbology, subsymbology. It was very academic and it was very fun to work in. But these days you've got a number of very large companies working towards, you know, actually having smarter and smarter things in our world driven by artificial intelligence. As we know, there's exponential growth in the world, and AI and intelligence in computing is being driven up. In fact, Google's driving to have rat-level intelligence by the end of this year. And if we look out another 10 to 15 years into the future, we could actually have something that's the same power as the human brain. And if we go a little further, we can actually have something that's more powerful than all human brains. Process more information, make better decisions. What does that do to the world? Well, lots of innovation, lots of great companies. I know that there's some great research happening here at the University of Waterloo. I think that AI is going to be one of the most fundamental and foundational elements of modern life. I think that academic institutions are a great part of that story, and I think that a lot of companies are going to spin out from that academic research. And I love this quote. So Andrew Ng from Baidu says, AI is the new electricity. When electricity came out, the world changed fundamentally. Yeah? And now when AI gets to a certain point, the world changes fundamentally. How we operate in it, what our role is, how we work with it. But then, you know, we've got some of these problems still. So Polanyi was this philosopher in the late 60s. He came up with this paradox. And his paradox is saying we can know more than we can tell. So we can know by having experience and living our lives. But it's very difficult to tell what our experiences are and for me to say, okay, this is how I drive a car. So I can teach you how to drive the car, but in 5 years' time, you really know how to drive a car, right? And there's this tipping point again. So last year, Google developed this technology called AlphaGo. And AlphaGo was an AI that beat the ninth Dan world champion at Go, Lee Sedol, four games to one. By using intuition and creativity in playing this incredibly complex game Go. But what's really interesting, in the last couple of weeks, it quietly existed on the internet and played every single grandmaster it could lay its hands on in China. Played 60 games and didn't get beaten once. So this game is like 1,000 times more complex than chess. Kasparov got beaten by Deep Blue, IBM's AI. He was distraught and broken. And that was in the mid-90s. And now we've got this technology that's just beating everyone. It's something complex that needs creativity and intuition and can read someone else's moves. And this is a piece of artificial intelligence. I love this quote at the end. This time humans are equally stunned, but perhaps less resistant. Back in the day, it was like, AI, we're going to die. And now it's like, oh, this could be quite cool. This could change the world. But what I think is really interesting about AI, it's going to augment our world. But how are we going to operate with it? Because as humans, we need to amplify what intelligence we have. Because we're intelligent beings. We can do a lot of things that computers can't do. And we'll be able to do that for a long, long time. So how can we amplify our intelligence by using this technology? So AI makes machines autonomous and detached from humans. IA, on the other hand, puts humans in control and leverages computing power to amplify our capabilities. I think that's really important. And I think that this is where AI is really going to flourish as it becomes IA. I was just over at the Nano Research Facility. Amazing. Nanorobotics is one thing. This is actually from the HoloLens. I actually think that putting artificial intelligence in a mixed reality world will help doctors actually not need cadavers to cut up so that they can learn how to do surgery or certainly do earlier stages of their learning and research. And this is real stuff, right? That's pretty cool. EEG helmets. Right. I wonder what this kid's thinking. It's probably like controlling three drones in the air right now. But that ability, and there's lots of research in this area. How can we plug ourselves in directly to the AI and actually make it work for us? There's like people speculate on brain mesh. It's all sorts of cool stuff. And I call us in this state and where we're going with this radical transhumans. We're born with this platform. We can upgrade, right? I mean, I've got an NFC chip in my hand, so I no longer need house keys. So I just walk home, I scan my front door, and it lets me in. Right? That's transhumanism. The use of smart drugs, other things, is pretty cool. And I'm calling these the big brothers. So there's no more big brother. It's the big brothers. You know, Google DeepMind, IBM Watson, Facebook, Amazon, Microsoft, they're all pushing it ahead in this field of expertise around AI and IA. So here's my first prediction in this area. AI will become more powerful in smaller mobile devices, which is a big problem right now, but they're getting there. and will start to become ubiquitous in all systems. Remember when we said, oh, there's going to be a sensor in everything? There's going to be AI and sensors and everything within smaller devices all over the world. Researchers, academic researchers, will start to work out how best as we humans can coexist and benefit with this integrated in our lives. Tech companies are great at saying, here's a thing, push it out into the world. But we're very good at then saying, have you thought about using this for this and this and this? And researchers are going to be ahead of the game and saying, oh, actually, we're going to work with you that are building the technology to start building proper applications. Algorithmic ethics definitions, data sanitization, and transformation development will be fast rising disciplines. If you want to have a really well paid job in the next like 15 to 20 years, get into ethics, work out how you can encode that, how you can build that into artificial intelligence. We're going to have like AI trainers, AI psychologists. It's going to be really interesting. And then I was just reading an article, and this was with the guy from Baidu the other day, about chief information officers and how organizations change. So CIOs will actually transform to have ethical responsibility around how AI learns and is applied to their organizations. Because AI is not smart enough to pick and choose the right data. We put in what we want it to learn about. So you can actually build bias into your systems through data. It's actually very dangerous. Imagine if you go into a bank and the people that trained a loan application system that uses AI, it doesn't need to use humans, a certain bias against people that had a poorer level of education because their application form they filled out had bad handwriting, right? You're not allowed to do that as a human advisor. As an AI, you could absolutely use that as a risk factor. That's not cool. So you've got to take into consideration some of these areas around building bias through AI. So data and considerations, ethics, and these ethical frameworks are going to be a big area. So like, if you, again, you want a great job going forward, that's going to be a fantastic thing to work in. Okay. Right. Are you still with me? Yeah? Okay, this is when it gets really fun. So retail, commerce, we still go out there, we still buy things. We want to use our mobile devices to do more. There was a company last year called Viv. The guys that created Siri then created this other technology called Viv, and it was bought by Samsung. It's incredible. It's interesting, right? Yeah, have you tried to do this before? Like, yeah, you just sit there ambiently, like speaking in the middle of the air, and your phone picks it up, right? And this, has anyone used an Amazon Echo at all? Yeah. So one of my neighbors has got it, and he bought it and put it on the shelf. I said, "Hey Alexa, yes, I'd like to buy $1,000 worth of David Bowie CDs." And she goes, "I'm ready to check out." It's like, Tom, you need to lock down your Alexa device. What was amazing, like, it's actually good, and he did lock it down. It's cool. You can say, "Alexa, tell me a joke." It tells you bad jokes. It tells you the weather. It ambiently listens to you all the time. It stores all that information. It's implicated in a court case right now where they think it might actually be the last potential auditory witness to a murder. Amazon aren't releasing that data. It's pretty crazy, right? But what's interesting is the Consumer Electronics Show just happened in Vegas, but Amazon didn't have a booth. That's because dozens of companies have now announced plans to work with its API that powers like the Amazon Echo. So Amazon's platform is becoming the world's platform in many different devices. Amazon's going to become incredibly powerful. They actually think that Amazon's going to be the world's first trillion-dollar company. They're worth a lot of money today, and they've been a slow burn for a long time, but they're getting more and more powerful and doing more and more really cool things. And Amazon Echo and this kind of ecosystem is going to be really important. And then they announced this last month, the Amazon Go.
4 years ago, we started to wonder, what would shopping look like if you could walk into a store, grab what you want, and just go? What if we could weave the most advanced machine learning, computer vision, and AI into the very fabric of a store so you never have to wait in line? No lines, no checkouts, no registers. Welcome to Amazon Go. Use the Amazon Go app to enter. Then put away your phone and start shopping. It's really that simple. Take whatever you like. Anything you pick up is automatically added to your virtual cart. If you change your mind about that cupcake, just put it back. Our technology will update your virtual cart automatically. So, how does it work? We used computer vision, deep learning algorithms, and sensor fusion, much like you'd find in self-driving cars. We call it Just Walk Out technology. Once you've got everything you want, you can just go. When you leave, our Just Walk Out technology adds up your virtual cart and charges your Amazon account. Your receipt is sent straight to the app, and you can keep going. Amazon Go. No lines, no checkout. No, seriously.
But the technology's crazy. How does it work? Well, cameras, AI, facial recognition. I actually wonder if people will be able to obfuscate their face to actually try and get away with it. We're going to see some really interesting behavior in the Amazon Go stores. This is actually down in Seattle, which is quite kind of close to where I live in Vancouver. But this is it. And you know what? Retailers are scared. These guys are going to buy thousands of stores across the world, and they're just going to drop their technology that's ready to go in, and all the other retailers in the world are going to go, how are we going to deal with this? Because who would rather use that every single day than to go to a normal supermarket, right? Yeah, like everyone. They've solved an incredible problem, right? And it's like, oh, and we charge your Amazon account. And then you can go and check your balance, and then we're going to recommend you a bunch of stuff, and then you order more things, and then Alexa at home is going to say, hey, have you run out of those eggs yet? And then it's going to become this ecosystem for our world. His prediction, traditional retailers will scramble to integrate technology and do a really, really bad job. Retailers do bad jobs at this. Like, you know, scanners, like tap technology, awful. And Amazon will purchase a major chain of stores and refit with complete autonomous systems, right? Apple will also revolutionize the conversational commerce space, like Viv. Why didn't Apple buy Viv? They had enough money, right? It's because they're working on something cooler, right? The next version of Siri. With advanced AI linked to their wallet, which isn't going so well, and to home devices to connect consumers to retailers, and to their augmented reality world, and then, oh, this ecosystem, it's all going to feel strange. Okay. Automation. There's a point where jobs that we want to do or jobs that we're working in or have worked in just fall below the API. We will be automated out of the way. And actually, there's a piece of research that came out of Ryerson recently that says that 42% of Canadian jobs are at high risk of being affected by automation in the next sort of 20 years or so. Right, and the top jobs within like the next 10 to 20 years, retail salesperson, food counter attendant, cashier, truck driver, I'm gonna come back to that. And then transportation is gonna be hugely disrupted. Autonomous cars are gonna be here. This is from Morgan Stanley, the bank. They actually think that we're gonna get to a utopian society by about 2025 of self-driving cars. I think that there will be self-driving cars. I don't think it'll be a utopian society. About 35,000 people a year die in North America from car-related accidents, and it's mostly because we're terrible drivers. Fewer and fewer kids these days are actually learning to drive. Fewer people are buying cars. And Tesla can update its entire ownership of Teslas overnight with a software update that makes all of their cars completely autonomous, right? Tesla isn't a car manufacturer. It builds a platform that goes wider into the world. And then Google's just come out with its new car, Waymo, and that's going to be open technology that's going to go into other car technologies. Uber released in both Philadelphia and San Francisco self-driving taxis. They had these in Singapore when I was there last year. It's pretty freaky. They actually said that they ran a red light in San Francisco, but apparently the driver took control and just hammered it through a red light. Humans are still pretty stupid at driving, right? And then you've got this company called Comma.ai. So the guy's the CEO and founder, George Holtz. He was the first guy to break an iPhone. He was the first guy to break a PlayStation. Last year, he decided to build a self-driving car in his garage in San Francisco. We want to be the Android. We want to be the mass provider of self-driving technology. And we have a platform ready to go. Call me. We're ready to go. And that was a call out to Chinese companies at CES interview, right? You can actually download all of his software and put a bunch of technology and cameras in your car and make it completely self-driving, like today, for thousands of dollars and low thousands of dollars, right? Then Uber bought this company, Otto, which is a kit that goes into lorries and trucks that turn them into self-driving trucks for low tens of thousands of dollars. About 3.5 million Americans in middle America drive trucks for a living. Go on. Pretty heavy when we get into these autonomous systems, right? And then we get into manufacturing. And we're seeing more and more output these days with manufacturing, with less and less employment. And as automation comes in and robotics comes in and they do a better, cleaner, cheaper job than we can do, it seems sensible to bring them into the factories. In fact, and ironically, Foxconn, that builds all the iPads and the iPhones, have actually come out with some new technology called the Foxbot. And this is going to affect China so deeply, and countries where manufacturing has been a boon for them, and where this is how they feed their people. They're going to put 60,000 people out of work this year in their factory, in their factories that build Apple phones. Right? This is not in Canada or whatever. We're going to have our own problems around, you know, autonomous systems. China needs to keep hundreds and hundreds of millions of people employed every year, and a lot of that's in manufacturing, and people are driving down and down costs. This is what's going to happen. You know, Donald Trump's talking about bringing manufacturing back to America. Sure. And the factories are going to be filled full of autonomous robots building things. It's not going to fix what Trump wants to fix. He's a little short-sighted. And as we can see from this graph, this is from the International Federation of Robotics. These are like the forecasts of purchase and implementation of robotics. Look at China, hey? Fewer people, more production, more robotics, cheaper per unit cost, happier Westerners going, yay! But not really happier Westerners, because you're still going to have the companies just increasing the margins and getting more wealthy, right? And then the banking system. I think the banking system is going to be completely changed by autonomous technology and AI. This is the world's largest hedge fund, Bridgewater Associates. The firm, which manages $160 billion, created the team of programmers specializing in analytics and AI, dubbed the Systematized Intelligence Lab, in early 2015, to actually put most of its traders out of work. Because you get more certainty, you get continuous training, the human factors disappeared from the markets, you have more integrity in the markets, less fluctuation, the world's a better place, right? And ultimately, they make more money. Seems sensible. So it's not just the blue-collar workers on the factory floor that are going to lose their jobs. It's like the guys in New York that are flitting around in their Ferraris earning $3 million a year aren't going to have anything to do either. Kind of makes me chuckle. But here's my big prediction here. Open source AI will drive progression in automation at an exponential rate. That means that it's going to get faster and faster and faster in terms of the leaps forward that we make, with startups performing R&D and large companies buying their IP. Large banks and other large companies are really bad at like building units to come up with great new ideas. Lots of small companies, fintech or whatever, are coming up with fantastic things. And banks are either going to partner or they're going to subsume them into their organization to do more. it's going to be really cool. And then I actually think it's going to accelerate in the next 3 to 5 years with mass unemployment in China, which is going to be a big problem, and large factory worker declines in the Western world as well. Government-sponsored online education hubs boom in this time due to cross-training people to work better in the information economy. We're going to have more people wanting to upskill and train into different areas of work. The creative arts are also going to boom as well. Okay, stop. So this is, we've gone through five areas, and it's all quite intense, right? Are you still with me right now? Yeah. Okay, and we're into the final one. And this is kind of something that we're going to have to watch quite carefully, and it kind of relates to what we talked about last night. A little bit. We are entering the world of cyber war. So this is when we get a little nervous. This is the internet in the late 60s. The internet was built to provide resilience against nuclear attacks. So if one of the hubs was taken out, all the other hubs could still connect to each other and talk to each other, right? Great, security. Then as we know, in 1993, 1994, the internet was released on the wider world. Tim Berners-Lee created HTTP and all of the protocols were in place. Fantastic. But people forget that the internet is just a bunch of cables around the world. It's not like this magic that flies around, you know. This was some of the problem with the whole NSA and the Snowden thing. And in Canada, we thought, no, but that's down in the States. Every time you make a phone call, your phone provider sends it to a tower and then routes it straight back through the internet that might go through the States as well. So it's kind of, you know, the internet is something that we use every day. And it's massive cables that live under the ocean. We forget this. But what do we do with all that power in our pockets? We take cat videos and we share stupid things, right? Now ask yourself the question, what do you do every day with the thing in your pocket? Because it's so powerful, it's a supercomputer, right? Criminals aren't using it for cat videos. They're using it to steal your credit card data. They're using it to potentially hijack power grids, hijacking traffic grids. San Francisco's transit system was hijacked. Luckily, they had a very secure backup, so they could just take it down, bring it up online. In fact, the hacker that got hacked later on that day by someone in San Francisco in a form of retribution and had all their Bitcoin taken. That was quite funny. You can hack cars. This is a very famous article in Wired magazine about hacking a Jeep from afar, wirelessly, and taking over. That's quite dangerous. But what's really interesting is that malware and ransomware attacks have been increasing. In 2014 and 2015, there was about 4,300 reports by the FBI that reported losses of over 50 million. There are hospitals in California that were being hijacked and said, okay, we'll release it for 5 bitcoins. But right now we've hijacked your entire hospital. What do? They pay the fine. And then they put security around. And then we've got the Internet of Things that surrounds us, all these sensors and smartness and connectivity. What does that do? Well, someone developed a program and released that out into the world open source called Mirai. And on October the 21st last year, most of the largest internet services in eastern US and on the eastern state border and out into Europe were actually hijacked. And people like Netflix, Twitter, Spotify, Reddit, CNN, PayPal, Pinterest, and Fox News, and a number of different newspapers were basically hijacked by this virus that took them down. Now, this is a DDoS attack, right? Denial of service. You flood websites with more traffic than they can handle, and then it just balks and stops. But now, you've got all the devices in the world attacking you, as well as all the computers in the world. And by 2025, Cisco think that there's going to be about 50 billion devices in the world. What happens when we go home and our microwave decides to attack us by switching off our cell phone? Or locking the door to our bedroom because, you know, we need to go down to the gym and work off the pizza we just ate, right? Kind of sounds a bit funky, but we're going to be surrounded in a world where we're going to have to be very aware with security and how data's used that we generate. What was interesting about Mirai, it just used factory standard, like, default passwords. So it's as simple as just locking things down by changing your password, right? And then the election was hacked, right? And Russia didn't care. The Russian embassy actually called Barack Obama a lame duck and put this out on Twitter. It's a comedy of errors. It doesn't seem real, right? It's a psychedelic cultural reality. This is what I'm calling it. But here's the prediction: increased open source malware, interference, hacks, security awareness, and politicization of hacking will increase. Spending in penetration testing, people breaking into your systems, security software, in-house security experts for all kinds of information and entertainment-based businesses are going to increase. This is a great career path if anyone wants to have a great career path. Increased enrollment in cybersecurity career courses at college and micro courses at all levels of business. Everyone in your organization is going to get training. Housewives and house husbands and families and all sorts of configurations are going to learn how to be secure. Little Jimmy at the age of 10 is like, it's time to do your cybersecurity course. It's like, okay, Dad. He's like, by the way, I've hacked through it already. It's like, what do you mean? It's like, I now control the fridge, your car. No, anyway. So the world feels kind of weird, right? After all that information. But where do we go to next? Whatever field we need to get into and start thinking about, and as academics and people doing coursework and going out into the real world, we still need to come back to who we are. We're humans. And the things that don't change are like the six basic things that define who we are, which is our need for certainty and variety and significance, the connection and love that we need in the world, the growth that we want to have in our lives and the contributions that we want to make. This will never change, unless you're a sociopath and then a bunch of them don't count. But really, normal humans, it doesn't change. So 2017 to 2025 will be a golden era for consumer technologies, and they're going to fundamentally change society. They're either going to keep us locked into distractions, or they're going to make us supremely empowered, and I hope that they make us supremely empowered. You always have to have epic music at the end of a presentation. Right? But it's super interesting, right? You go back to this film from all those years ago, and I'm playing it because we've got a choice that we can make in this world, and we can retain our humanity and know that technology is just part of our world and that we're not part of technology's world, right? I love The Matrix as well. Anytime I can fit that into a presentation, it's brilliant. So do we turn on? Do we tune in? Do we drop out? I think more than anything else, we tune in. Welcome to the future. Thank you very much. Okay, any questions? Yeah, yes, sir.
First of all, I think that the psychedelic view is pretty awesome, and the comparison with Timothy Leary and so on, I think that makes real sense. But the question is, we are following a trend, and all the predictions that we have over here are quite amazing. But on the other hand, politically, the world's living a very weird moment, a lot of protectionism, and people that's getting to the governments that want to protect their barriers and previous thoughts about borders and so on. And how, let's say, a government of China would try to prevent these new technologies to be implemented, and how these would, let's say, probably make the space go a little bit slower because of this protectionism and these a way that governments and people want to protect their own interests that these amazing technologies just putting down the barriers.
Yeah, it's a great question. I don't think governments are slowing anything down. I think China's accelerating in a number of different areas. For example, renewable energy, they're gonna have like 33% of the world's renewable energy within like 5 years. They're building huge Asian super grids that run across multiple countries, driving renewable energy so to replace like coal. You would have thought China would stop that, right? They're accelerating it. And they're accelerating all this technology. At the CES show, and Kate was talking about this last night, one of Kate's colleagues at the MIT Media Lab, Cynthia Brazil, has built this personal robot called Jibo. And you go to the CES show, and there's 8 robots that look like Jibo from China. I don't think China's stopping anything. I think China's taking it further and faster than ever before. In fact, the Google Tango is sort of an augmented reality scanning device, bringing in LiDAR data and a whole bunch of different things. And it's like it's a Chinese company that's taken it to market first. These are the disruptors, right? I think America is not going to stop the tech companies from driving forward. No one can stop the tech companies from coming up with amazing new ways of looking at the world. Right? Unless they're doing something illegal. But hey, everyone signs the terms and conditions when we use systems, right? Hands up who read the Facebook terms and conditions when they signed up. I go to security conference and there's always like 3 guys going, yeah, me. And then I say, did you read them last week? Because there was a clause in the original terms and conditions say that they can update it at any point in time, right? Yeah, we sign our lives away. We sign the identity of ourselves, and Snowden talked about this last night. We sign our right to be ourselves away to these tech companies. Can we stop the tech companies like by fighting against that? Yeah, by not using their services. But then the rest of the world goes ahead with us. So no one's going to stop us apart from ourselves. But you know, there's a point where we get swept up in everything, right? I'm a really late adopter of some technology. Like I'm really, really late at getting some things, and it's kind of insane because I'm a futurist, right? But like. I do so much reading about it that I wait for the tipping point for me to get drawn into it. It's like, that's an indicator of a wide adoption. Yeah, but like, yeah, countries aren't going to stop anyone. In fact, governments are going to help these organizations to go further. And those 7 companies in the US have now got a table at the president's table, right? And he's not going to stop any of them. Well, some of the people in his cabinet, or even, you know, there's going to be tensions. But these companies are great American companies that have got $2.5 trillion, right? It's a good question. Yeah.
I know countries like North Korea.
Yeah.
I think they have their own internet.
Yeah. I think it's the Red Internet or something like that, right?
Yeah. How does that, because you're talking about cyber attacks and all that, how does that separate them from these kind of cyber attacks? Is it because they have their own kind of internet? Does that give them any advantage? That's what I'm asking over.
If something's connected and it can plug into a wall anywhere in the world, it's not safe, right? Or can work on Wi-Fi or whatever. Yeah, they're just part of the world ecosystem. Sure, there's a bunch of firewalls. It's mostly to stop North Koreans getting out or finding information from the outside world. Yeah, North Koreans can get. In certain agencies within North Korea, they can still get wherever they want. And I'm sure as hell that like intelligence agencies around the world can go knocking on the door and sneak in the back door to go and take a look at what they do. Some very, very smart people in North Korea, though. Yeah, for sure. Allegedly behind like the Sony attacks, like, discuss, you know. Difficult to prove some of this stuff, though, right?
You talked about the bias an algorithm can develop.
Yeah. Yeah.
But there is a difficulty where all these layers keep updating their weights and you can't really go and find the credit.
Yeah.
Which layer did what. And you've seen some examples of black box trading where suddenly billions of dollars got wiped out.
Yep.
And now who do you blame? Do you blame the programmers? Do you blame who gets to have the credit when it works well and who gets to have the blame when it doesn't work?
It stops at the top of the organization at this point. There's going to be so many people feeding into it. It's a great point. So many data points. This is why data sanitization, checking, profiling, training before letting it out on the real world has to sort of come into pass, right? There's actually a really interesting interview with Barack Obama and a bunch of people from MIT about AI and how that works and what that could mean for banking as well, right? So go and take a look at that, but it's all about this implication. And there's some of these ideas around, you know, having a big red button to stop things, right? Suddenly, if the world is trading and it's all AI and it's all algorithmic and it's all like learning and deep learning, and suddenly there's a bad part of the system, how do you stop all the other parts of the system from feeding off of that and learning off of that, right? There's a lot of challenges to make it really seamless for that wide mass adoption. These use cases, like with the hedge funds and whatever, are very specific examples of trading. Now, it's when it goes across the board that it gets very, very interesting, you know. But all we do as humans is we look at data and the analytics that are there. We look at the volatility curves in derivative trading or whatever. And we make a judgment call. And I'm absolutely certain that a computer can make a better judgment call than we can.
And in like microseconds.
Yeah, nanoseconds. Yeah. And this is a really interesting point. Investment banks have to operate faster than the other investment banks to make the most money. They've actually, I was told this when I was in New York and it fascinated me. There's actually large banks in New York that will move half a block. They will move entire data centers at half a block to make their data transmission faster so they could make more money. Because do you know what? 20 meters counted. It's crazy. And AI is the next level above like the human trading and the fast data transmissions about like, yes, that trade. AI is just like tick, 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 tick. Yeah.
And a quick follow-up question.
Yeah.
So now if all this AI is also open source and crowdsourced, and you don't know who committed code when, and you know, we have pull requests,
yeah.
And it kind of messed up things, now what?
Yeah, but you know, with open source systems, you've still got the gatekeepers, you've still got the people that make sure that everything is working pretty well. I mean, it's not as innocuous as say like Linux or something like that that's open source. You know, the open source like autonomous driving cars, there's not always going to be great code in there, but there's always going to be someone that's at the end that's going to be like doing the final quality assurance, the final checking. We're still going to need that. That's going to be a really good job for someone as well. Yeah, great question. Great question. Sure.
Specific absorptive rate.
Okay.
SAR.
Okay.
SAR levels, which the WHO kind of brought up. That,
yeah.
That cell phones and their usage and
yeah.
Keeping them close. So as a futurist, what do you see? Will there be might be a backlash with this? So many gadgets affecting us.
Yeah.
Surrounding us, that everything we are doing, smartphones and extension to your limbs, and you are just surrounded with all this radiation.
Yeah.
Would this somewhat the future in some way?
Yeah, I think so. Like, yeah, there's this great image of like Pikachu riding this guy with this prolonged neck walking along like that, right? I'll tell you a couple of stories. So, and you know, these are personal stories. Who plays Sugar Candy Crush here? Or who has played Sugar Candy Crush? Yeah. Who's ever had tennis elbow from playing Sugar Candy Crush? So I had a big phone, I was playing it a lot. I think I was bored, I was traveling a lot. I started getting pains in my elbow, right? This isn't radiation, but, and it took me 3 months to fix it. And it was from using my cell phone to play a game. And then I put into that hand and I got, I'm not joking, I was that stupid, right? And we've got kids in Korea that are using screens so much from such an early age, for so many hours every day, that by the ages of 18 and 19, they develop something called digital dementia. So their brains display forms of dementia because the right side of the brain hasn't formed properly because of the, you know, the light frequencies that come into their eyes. When we've got things like Microsoft HoloLens, I met one of the R&D directors from way back in the day, who shall remain nameless. He goes, yeah, we don't know what it does to the eyes. We'll just see what happens, right?
Yeah.
All these screens, ergonomic design, all that. Actually, I think that when we get to a world when we're walking around and it's all voice command and it's visual, we're going to act more like humans. But we're not going to be used to that reality for a long time. We're going to have to learn when to tune out and be humans, right? In terms of radiation, I don't have an opinion on that. I think we need to be really careful of what we do plug in. I've met people that want to chop off their arms and put cybernetic limbs on and whatever, right? I get it. We're going to have to design technology that's safe for people to use, right? The radiation, whatever, you know. People have been working on that for a long, long time, but it's a really, I've never been asked that question before. That's fantastic.
In our childhood, they told us stay away from the TV for three meters, and yeah. Now it's about 3 centimeters.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
It's kind of the change of technology.
Yeah. If you ever go to a restaurant and you see someone that's got a kid that's like 2-3 years old and they're using a phone like that, just walk up to them and tell them the story about the South Korean kids and dementia. Make sure you do that. There's a very, very big federal politician, and his kid was in the wheelchair, and it was a handicapped kid, right? It was really bad, and it was like, I'm sorry. He was an honorable guy, right? I'm sorry, but like, you really need to stop your kid from using this technology like that. And he was in charge of like one of the digital 150 strategies as well, and it doesn't always go down very well. But they're going to realize down in the end that kids are going to be bad. Yeah. In fact, the people that work in deep, advanced technology don't let their kids use it hardly at all, because they know what's happening, right? Yeah.
You mentioned that the increase of unemployment due to the fact that some job positions will be replaced by machines.
Yes. How will people consume in an age when they have less financial power? Yes? Well, there's a lot of discussion around the implementation of things like universal basic income. So to replace like the Social Security system with people getting a standard, everyone in this room would get like $2,000 to $2,500 a month, standard, everyone in the country. And then you'd have jobs on top of that that would earn you more money. And for that basic subsistence of living. They're doing experiments with this in like Finland and a number of different countries around the world. In fact, one of the earliest experiments using this form of universal basic income was actually done in Dauphin, Manitoba, 40 years ago. And the research was hidden so far underneath a pile of papers because it worked really, really well. But it was so early. People were more productive, people were happier, people worked longer hours, people were more healthy, because they knew that they were above the poverty line and that they could eat every day, they could like feed their kids and put clothes on their backs, right? Where are we going to be in the future? We're going to earn less money, we're going to have things like universal basic income, and we're going to be less focused on possession of things, right? People joke about how many black t-shirts I own, right? There's a point in like, I actually gave away most of my stuff last year. It was a very liberating and slightly scary experience. Yeah. 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 How do we see governments like China handling this mass unemployment? Badly. Do you know what? That is a real conundrum out there right now. They must be looking at this. I mean, in 2015, they had to create 100 million jobs to keep the economy buoyant. Watch the Chinese economy over the next 2 years, because it's going to seem like a happy place for the next year. And then like the plaster's gonna be ripped off, you know, the Band-Aid's gonna be ripped off, and we're gonna see a very, very difficult time for China going forward. I don't know how they're gonna deal with it. Things like universal basic income, again, these sort of like ways of lowering and equalizing salary and the way to provide food cheaper or whatever, it becomes a bigger country and government level problem. Yeah, and they've had that problem before in China, right? Okay, where are we? At the back there.
With the secrets that a lot of companies are keeping about their development processes and yeah. Different technologies, how do you kind of filter out kind of the not so true stuff that people are talking about? And the one example I'm kind of thinking of is Theranos.
Yeah.
So where they make these claims, and then it turns out their technology isn't exactly what they had said. How do you kind of predict?
Yeah. So, yeah. You don't. You just wait until it gets revealed as being not real, right? I mean, you can get a sense of what's real and what's not. Theranos was a multi-billion dollar company, did testing, right? Blood tests, I think. They just laid off another 41% of their staff just this week. The girl that ran it, she was like the golden girl. Like, she was phenomenal. Like, these tests are so cheap, but they didn't work. But they found out that they didn't work, you know? I imagine someone at the FDA and you know, around, you know, there's someone in America very high up in government that's got a big like egg on their face through this whole thing, right? It gets found out. These secret development processes, what people feed into the world. There's little snippets of what the future could look like. But you've got to remember, in their research and development labs, they're already 10 years in the future, right? It doesn't look pretty yet, right? It's like with that augmented reality. It's like helmets this big, you know? But it looks incredible, but they're just like, no one's going to wear it, right? Yeah. Yeah. I've met people that do, and they've told me absolutely nothing. Because, like, I think that, you know, the privacy agreement around that is incredible. But, like, you know what? They're just waiting until it's small enough so that the world doesn't go, ooh. And what, you know, judging by what people have said, when they try them on. I mean, Google walked into this office above a dentist in Florida. I think, not Dayton Beach, somewhere in Florida, into this room and tried it and wrote them a check for $540 million the next day. You know, there's something there, right? What are we going to do about these private things that happen behind the scenes? Well, I think we just need to select what we want to be part of when it comes out, right? Okay, did we say
two
one
more? Questions.
Two more questions. Two more questions. Yes.
You talked about the new power that technology companies have with governments.
Yes.
But traditionally, companies have been held somewhat accountable by their consumers.
Mm-hmm.
How do you see the role of consumers in the future and how that evolves?
Which tech companies do you think have been held accountable by their consumers?
Maybe not tech companies, but traditional.
Okay.
Traditional.
Like retailers or whatever, right? We're the product, right? We use things for free like Facebook and whatever. We get cheaper goods through Amazon and whatever. The data we produce is the product that makes their business better. And they say, hey, we're making this better for you as well. We just got to choose, you know, Amazon Go. Sure, I want to use Amazon Go. Like, why not? But they're going to use all the facial recognition when I select that salad. Nick was really happy when he had that salad. Nick's 44. He lives in Vancouver. Like, here's his income level, blah, 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 blah. And now I'm going to use that as analytical data to profile people in my database. And the next time I walk in, there's going to be a wall full of things that complement that salad, right? Do consumers have a say? We will have a say by our behavior, but it's going to feel really weird. You know, it's like when Amazon, when it first came out and recommended three books that you'd like to read. It's like, actually, I would. It's like, how did it know that, right? It feels a bit weird, right? So how are we going to feed into it? By actually using it. And that's kind of the scary, sad thing. But also it's a very empowering thing that suddenly our world's better, but people are driving us to purchase more, to spend more money, not to do more good in the world. And that's what I want to see a lot of big tech companies do, is to actually turn their focus in all of this greatness that they've got into good in the world. People like Google and Google and Facebook are doing a lot with artificial intelligence and with healthcare. So if you actually turn that huge database of information over onto cancer or onto, you know, degenerative diseases, you're going to solve a lot of problems in the world. And you mix that with some of the great developments that we're making, like quantum computing here or whatever. There's going to be something really interesting that happens, like, in you know, 20, 30 years into the future, you know, it's going to feel quite liberating, but, like, it's going to have to be with the benevolence of the people that run tech companies. But, like, you know, Bill Gates has already started pushing that, like, you know, Larry Page, Sergey Brin, you know, there's good people in the world. And then you've got people that just want to make as much money as they can that won't be that benevolent, right? So, yeah. I mean, they're outside of the realm of North America mostly, so yeah. Yeah. Look, watch Alibaba. Okay, one more question. Yes.
I wanted to know that do you have any idea how will be the energy production look like?
Energy production,
yeah,
in the future. I'm actually flying to Prince George, which would be colder than this. I guarantee it will be colder than this. On the 30th of January, and I'm giving two talks at the Premier's Forum for Natural Resources. What would the future look like for natural resources? We're the natural resources. Solar, wind, water are the natural resources. Going forward, oil will become obsolete as a fuel. Coal will become obsolete as a fuel. We're going to stop, you know, digging holes in the ground. But then, you know, there's a conundrum. Natural resources built this computer, right? It built the data centers that we're going to need in the future. We're still digging the earth for the metals that we need, right? But from an energy perspective, solar is going through the roof. there's Tesla worked with, I think it's Samoa, American Samoa. The entire island is now powered by solar, and it uses Tesla batteries to store energy overnight. Right? We're going to see that. Elon Musk has very famously said that if people could actually help him build 10 gigafactories that he's building, he could solve the world's energy needs. So solar is really important. Hydro water is really important, especially for us up in Canada. I think we're going to see a change. What's interesting about Canada and the landscape in Canada is we're a country built on natural resources. And we ship oil down south, and we do a whole bunch of stuff that's maybe not so great for the environment. In fact, it's terrible for the environment. But what does Canada look like in 30 or 40 years' time when we've no longer got natural resources? We've weathered lots of recessions because we've got that resilience in natural resources. What does Canada look like when we no longer have that as a crutch? We no longer sell lots of lumber. We decide not to do that. What does a technologically advanced Canada look like? I'm working on that. Solar is a major part of that solution. And biocrops, because we're not gonna convert a lot of combustion engines very quickly, but there's gonna be about a third to 30 or 40% of the world is gonna run on biofuel, including airplanes. They actually just ran a biofuel run with Alaska Airlines just before Christmas. I think it's gonna be very interesting. It's one of the biggest problems we're gonna solve as well.
Great way to end it.
Yeah, great questions. Thank you.